Okay, so welcome everybody. So it's a pleasure to introduce David Cueco. David Cueco did his PhD in the University of Zaragoza in 2007. Then he spent 4 years with Peter Hange in the University of Augsburg in Germany. And then he was an ARAID researcher. I don't know the meaning of ARAID researcher. So he's a kind of Ramón y Cajal within the Aragon
Investigación.
And since 2020, he's a scientific titular in the Institute of Nanoscience and Materials of Aragon. Regarding the research lines, he's a world leading expert on theory of open quantum system, quantum optics with the emphasis on strongly correlated systems and many body and ultrasound coupling. And besides, for obtaining money, for getting money, he also says that he's an expert on quantum technologies. Okay, so David, this joke is from David. Okay.
Gracias por la introducción. So thank you very much, Antonio Francisco, for the invitation. It's always a pleasure to be here in Madrid. This is the title of my seminar. Maybe it's not very descriptive, so let me start already with the talk. So this is the problem I would like to discuss with you today. So the idea is that we have a material. So you can imagine that you have a spin lattice or some electrons. This material is placed inside a cavity, and then you ask the question if the properties of the material has changed because it's placed in the cavity. In particular, I would like to discuss what happens when this material, these spins, these electrons interact with the quantum fluctuations of light inside the cavity. These quantum fluctuations generate some matter-matter interactions generated by photons that create new interactions and can change the, for example, bulk properties of the material. I will discuss some examples. It's also true that if the properties of the material change, also the properties of the cavity can change. For example, it can happen some kind of photon condensation because of the coupling with the matter. But today I will focus on matter. So the idea is that I have the material, I place inside the cavity, and then I work the theory by such that I want to trace out the cavity degrees of freedom, the light degrees of freedom, and then I will end up in an effective theory only for the matter with some effective interactions generated by that. Okay. So why it is not perturbative? Let me just justify this word of the title. So imagine that you have a two-level atom close to a waveguide, okay, to make things simpler. And then you are thinking the partial effect, which means that the modification of the spontaneous emission of the two-level system, in this case, very simple, because of the coupling to this to the photons traveling in the waveguide. Okay, this is a modification of spontaneous emission compared to the spontaneous emission in free space. Okay. So this is, I mean, you can use, for example, Fermi golden rule. So you can use perturbation theory. But now it can also happen, but the ground state, so the properties of the system is still a two-level system with a well-defined delta. In fact, photons typically are around this delta, which is the level splitting of the two-level system. So really, you are not modifying the properties of the two-level system, okay? But if the coupling between the two-level system and the waveguide becomes strong enough, then already at the ground state becomes non-trivial. Why is not trivial? For example, you can do the calculations that you cannot use now a perturbation theory. For example, you can use a normalization group, and then you compute how the delta is renormalized because of the cap. This is just I not entering the details what does mean coupling. There's coupling between the two-level system and the waveguide. But essentially, something you obtain is that the delta R, the renormalized frequency, renormalized to C. Okay, so you are changing the equilibrium properties of this very simple material, which is just a two-level system, just because of the car. And in the same way, you are also, because the ground state is not trivial, you also have some cloud or localized virtual photons around the two-level system because of the strong correlations emerging between the coupling, between the two-level system and the waveguide. Okay, this is the famous problem that we find in this review of the physics of Leggett already in the 80s for the spin boson model. This is a very well studied model because you can map it to the Kondo problem. So with this idea in mind, a strongly correlated system of states between light and matter, we can think now in having not only an emitter, but a material, so a bunch of emitters, okay? Also, these emitters can have the intrinsic interaction because they are material, okay? So the idea is, as I explained you before, so I have quantum fluctuations of light inside the cavity, so this generates some matter-matter effective interactions, typically long range. Okay, this is typically with the wavelength of the photons, so the photons typically have the same wavelength of the cavity, so they affect the correlation, the range of the interactions are typical long range, and several people has discussed this problem in terms of, for example, modifying the superconductivity of a material, ferromagnetism, ferroelectricity, or even the topology. So this is a really very incomplete list, and this is a review by Fejota recently discussing this kind of thing. Here in La Autónoma, you are experts on doing other things also, like modifying the chemical reactions or obtain the transport of system because of these long range interactions. But I will be more focused in the changing the good properties of materials in this sense. Well, the previous slide was theoretical approaches. So in last year, in fact, appeared three experiments. Here I will discuss two of them. The first one is by the group of Evesen, published in Nanoletters last year, and they essentially put this how it's called, Evacua material, I think is the name, right? It's Yttrium nanoparticles. They put inside of a polymer matrix in order to couple these nanoparticles to the phonon band of the polymer, that this phonon band, it seems that interacts with the substrate, okay? As far as I understood. Okay, so at the end, they have an effective coupling between the material and the polarity, the plasmons of this cavity. I don't know if you can call it cavity, but let's call it cavity. It turns out that in their experiments, what they observe is that because of this mediated coupling, because of this coupling to the plasmons, they have some ferromagnetism enhancement. Okay, this is the magnetization. The red curve is when they couple to the cavity, and the black dots are the material in the bare material, the material just in free space without coming to the cavity. So this is the message of the paper. The collective coupling, they have enhancement of the poor properties of the material. Another example is by the group of Feist in the EPH, where they have a 2D electron gas and they put a resonator on top of this. This is the resonator, okay? And they study the transport properties, in particular the whole conductivity of the 2D electron gas. And what they observe is because of the long order interactions generated by the resonator, by the cavity, some plateaus of the resistivity are breakdown, so the topology breaks down because of the coupling to the quantum fluctuations of light. Okay, so essentially in this case was the long order which breaks down the topological protection of the whole set. So these are experiments. So let's come back to the theory. So as you see, some challenges. Okay. So there are a lot of situations. So it's difficult to have a unified picture, a unified theory, because you have different materials, different types of cavities or resonators, different experimental layouts, etc. Besides, the thing can be very complicated because we are searching for strongly correlated effects. So you need to take some care with them, how to model the system. In particular, for example, I like this example already all, where they consider these perovskites put thin fields of perovskites put between two electrodes. Okay, in this case, two platinum electrodes. So this is what they say. In my mind is this thing. Okay, they have something in the middle, so like a sandwich. Okay. Well, and in the next slide, I'm going to present you a light matter interaction, but in principle, this model can be very simple. This is how they solve the problem. They already understand the coupling of this material to the two plates already by like a hybrid material. So they use DFT to model everything. Okay, the atoms of the platinum, the thin material in the middle, and the atoms of the platinum. Okay, so the modelization already to see the effects can be very difficult. Okay? And in fact, the modifications of the properties don't need to be with the quantum fluctuations of light. Maybe it has just surface effects because you are interacting with another surface, with another material that changes the properties of your own material. Okay, this can be very complicated. But here I will do the things as simple as possible. So I will take the Pauli Hamiltonian, so the light matter interaction, and then I will investigate how these quantum fluctuations can affect. But already at this point, it's already a many body problem. Okay, so typically you need to do approximations. You can use typically adiabatic elimination, dispersive, some polar approximation, perturbation theory, mean field, etc. Okay, so our idea in this work was trying to put the approximations at the end to see how far we can reach treating the model as exact as possible. As we can, okay. In particular, just only considering the limit of n large. So we are considering material, so we are going to assume that the number of emitters tends to infinity. Okay. So, but let me explain you the simplest model, which is this is historically the first example of the seminal example of this cavity QD material, which is the so-called Dicke model and the resolution by Hepp and Leaf and one and Kyo already in the 70s. Okay, they consider the simplest scenario where they have just a single move cavity. So this is the cavity with frequency capital omega. You have independent emitters, so if they are not coupled to the cavity, they are independent. And each qubit, each emitter, sorry, is coupled to the cavity, to the typically dipole interaction. Okay, and this is the coupling. I will discuss later on this why I write lambda over the square root of n, and n is the number of emitters. So in the resolution of Hepp and Leaf and one and Kyo, they discovered that maintaining the density of the emitters constant in the limit n to infinity, okay, you are putting considering that rho is constant, so essentially what you are doing is filling the cavity with material. Okay, at some point there is a second order phase transition where the photons, the average of the field becomes different from zero, and the order, because this relationship between the average of the field and the order parameter of the meters is the total X magnetic field related to this quantity. So if this thing is different from zero, this thing is different from zero, so the matter becomes order. Okay. This is what is called the super-Ryan equilibrium phase transition and or the photon condition. Okay. This was predicted in the 70s, and I will discuss a little bit more later, and it has never been measured so far. Let me explain why is lambda over square root of n, just giving a simpler argument. Because sometimes one wonders if these interactions are how strongly you need to have these interactions to observe some effect. Okay, and already in the Dicke model, if you put n to infinity, the individual interaction per spin is become decreased tends to zero. Okay. Okay, you put like this, and then imagine that you have the physical origin of the edge of cupping can be electrical or magnetic, so the dipole interaction can be like this or like this. Then, if you are assuming electric field, then you quantize very simple. The electric field loop takes this form, and this quantity here, this function here, is the amplitude of the quantum fluctuations of the electric field. By the Villard theorem, at vacuum, you have a relationship between the square root, the power of 2 of this quantity and the frequency of the cavity times the volume. Here should be an integral, but I'm assuming that it's constant. And here it should be some constants to give the correct units, but doesn't matter. And then the strength is just given by this amplitude of the electric field, proportional to here. And you have the density of the sample, which is n over the volume of the sample. So you have, and then putting all together, you have that lambda square scales like this. Okay, as the frequency of the cavity, the density, and the which we call filling factor. Okay, how much are you covering of here? This is the mod volume of the cavity, the volume of the cavity, and the volume of the sample. And in fact, basically, you can only, in an experiment, depend on the material or whatever, you can maybe modify the density. And very important, you should try to emphasize, increase the filling factor. You should cover everything. But as you see, this is very simple, and this is what you obtain. You cannot do much more things. Okay, essentially depends only the coupling, depends on the density and this filling factor. This is rather general. Well, if you go to the quantum phase transition, you can think in these effective interactions. Believe me that if you do a second order perturbation theory, then you are going to have something in interaction. You are going to have at second order, you are going to have something like lambda square over n, and then sigma is sigma x, because sigma x, this spin is going to be interacting with other sigma x mediated by the photons. So it's going to have this form. It's going to be an easy model, but the decay transition is in the within the universitary class of the easy transition. And if you do a mean field argument, since you have lambda square over n, but you have n neighbors, then the critical coupling of the easy model goes as lambda. So in fact, and this is very nice, in these things, what matters for observing these transitions and these correlations is the collective coupling, not the individual coupling, but the collective coupling. Okay. Yeah, Hamiltonian. This is the Pauli Hamiltonian. So here you have the electronic Hamiltonian of materials, so electrons and protons. And then you couple to the electromagnetic field, so the minimal coupling in the Coulomb gauge. Okay, this is the vector potential of the electromagnetic field. And this is the Coulomb interaction, for example, and the electron-proton interaction, some interaction term, the Hamiltonian of the electromagnetic field, and maybe you have some spins, and then this is the Simon coupling. Okay, this is the non-relativistic limit of the Dirac equation. Here I put some primes here, because, okay, I can put primes, but the point is that maybe already you have image charges that modify somehow the pair Hamiltonian. Okay, I'm going to hide everything in this price. Okay. So I have this Hamiltonian. Then with this Hamiltonian, you can do a lot of things, but for example, you can eliminate the A squared term. This is very famous. You can consider that you don't have spins. And then you do the TLS projection. I mean, you are assuming that every emitter has the two relevant levels. After doing this, you can show very easily that from this general Hamiltonian, you end up exactly in the decay model. Okay. Also, you can neglect electron-electron interactions and everything like that. So there's a lot of approximations from the real one to the decay realization. It turns out that these things, this A squared term and the projection to two-level system, are fatal in the sense that these terms, in fact, are the ones that they give you the no-go theorems. That tells you that this Hamiltonian, the exact one, has not superior quantum phase transition. Okay, if you don't not consider the coupling to the spins or other things, okay, or spin-spin interactions, etc. Okay. So this is essentially the reason why this this transition has not been never measured, because in fact reaching the Dicke model is not trivial, okay, unless you are doing this. Okay, effective action. I promise that I would like to have an effective Hamiltonian for the matter only. So essentially the trick, or the mathematical trick, is to trace out the cavity fields in order to have like the density, the reduced density matrix only for the matter degrees of freedom. In this case, we use coherent path integrals. Why? Because the light, the electromagnetic field is essentially harmonic oscillators. So harmonic oscillators in path integrals are Gaussians, and we know how to solve Gaussians, right? We know how to solve harmonic oscillators. Okay, then this is the formula in a path integral to obtain this the trace over the electromagnetic field, and then you can write the partition function as the trace only over the matter over an effective axis. Okay, this is a trick we use. I mean, we did it because we have background in open systems, and this is typically done in open system, because in open system the environment is also a bunch of harmonic oscillators. Well, a lot of algebra here. Then I can go to the normal modes of the cavity. So I have I diagonalize the cavity with these bosons, and then I have this kind of matter boson model. In this coefficients C case, I hide everything there. So here are the mode functions for the cavity, etc. Okay, the momentum of the particles, etc. Okay. Here I do an approximation. Very important, and I promise not to make a lot of approximations, but here we did one. Here, when you want to express the, when you want to quantize the cavity, you have this A here. This A is expanded in terms of mode functions of the cavity. These are the U functions. Okay, these U functions are depend on the position of the meter. Okay, so when you quantize everything, this position becomes an operator, okay? And this mode function, for example, the simplest one, a cosine, right, is a nonlinear function. So it's not true that you are going to have harmonic oscillator. In fact, you are going to have very nonlinear functions of operators, and this is very complicated. Okay. What we do, for example, you can assume that the meters are fixed in space, okay? Because these positions are fixed, okay? Or are not fixed, but are fixed, but and then you do some Taylor expansion as a function of this fixed momentum. And so at the end, we want to have a bunch of harmonic oscillators. We do this, we argue that this is possible, but some people think that maybe this is not very okay, but it's okay. And we end up with this model that we can solve. We do the integrals and we obtain this action. Now the problem is that why we have an action, because if you trace out a Hamiltonian, you don't obtain a Hamiltonian, okay? Because you have correlation between the things, okay? If not, everything will be very simple, okay? I have a many body Hamiltonian, and then I trace everything except one, and then I solve one, then I solve the other. But if I trace the rest, this one is something complicated, because it shares some entanglement with the rest of some correlation. But you can write in terms of an action. This action, this is the Euclidean action at equilibrium. This U is the Riemannian time, but the problem is that it's non-local. Okay, you see they have this kernel in the integral, and it's not like you would like to have something local to convert this action into a Hamiltonian. This is why we make the limit n to infinity. Okay,
This was the for doing this work, we spent several months trying to find these things. And we have several ways of obtaining the same. I think three or four ways of obtaining the fact that in the limit of n to infinity, this kernel becomes local. Okay, it becomes a sum of delta functions. So if this is local, believe me that you can write the Hamiltonian, the action as local, and then the action becomes a Hamiltonian that looks like this. As you see, now the matter has the bare matter, maybe with some modifications of the of boundary conditions of the cavities, some electrostatic effects here. And a part of this, they have these interaction terms. This C now, these C operators are the operators essentially that couple to the line. Okay. And as you see, they are this index is the momentum of the mode functions. Okay. So this is the origin of the long range interactions. Okay. You have CC. For example, in the decay model, I told you that the emitters are coupled to the cavity to the light via sigma x. So these C's are sigma x, sigma x, sigma x. Okay. And this is important for me. This is an exact result in the limit n to infinity. But we can only prove this in the limit n to infinity. What does it mean n to infinity? Okay. So we need some numerics. This is for the decay model. So I come back here. So the simple one. Because we do numerics, we try the first one, okay? And we solve in the computer exactly the partition function of this model. This is still possible. We do some tricks for relative large number of emitters, and we do the effective theory and compute the partition function for the effective theory, and we compare. Okay. I just give you eight, and then I just give you results 500. Okay, now we are trying to reach something like thousands of spins, and you see the agreement. This is a low temperature, this is high temperature. This is the super radiant phase transition, in fact, that occurs with these parameters at lambda equal 0.5. Here you see that the partition function grows from 1 to 2 because there's a spontaneous symmetry breaking, so there's two degenerate states. So the ground state is not degenerate, this is because at zero temperature, the partition function is 2 here. And at high temperature, there is this peak around the transition. And here, the solid line is the exact numerics, okay? Exact numerical labelization of the decay model. And the open points are the effective theory, which is okay already for 500. Okay. It's only, as far as I remember, in the total area of the curve here in the high energy is less than 0.5% of the unit. Already 500, if I considering that they have 10 to something meters, we expect that this result should be better. Okay. We are trying to see how it converts to our exact bounds for infinity numerically now. How much time I have?
30 minutes.
Okay. 30. Okay. So I have this application now to magnet all this theory. I'm going to apply to a concrete problem, which is called then enhancement of ferromagnetism. We are thinking that we have a cavity. Later on, I will tell you another architecture, but these are superconductors, okay? And these are some capacitors and that act as the mirrors of a cavity, okay? And this is in fact a pictorial representation of the modes of the electric field and the magnetic field, okay? You can imagine that the magnetic field, that is what we are interested in, goes like this because of the rule of, I don't know, the right hand or whatever. It's just a cable. That is important. Okay. Then I put material or spins here, and then the spins, they are going to notice this magnetic field. Okay. And this is the origin of the coupling. Okay. And I want to cover all the modes of this cavity with the spins. Okay. This is
Okay. If I don't have electrons, if I just have spins, I know that the spins are in the electrons, but let me forget about the electronic Hamiltonian. If I only have spins, I don't have this A squared term. And I don't need to do the projection. It's already two-level system if I have spin and one half. So in fact, this problem is already a realization of the Dicke model without the problems of the no-go theorems. Okay. This is the Hamiltonian, and then I will give you some examples where this Hamiltonian is can be realized in the lab. So now I have the other. So I have I discussed with you harmonic oscillators. Now the second one, which is the AC model, okay. And then I have the AC model in 1D, so I can solve, for example, with Jordan Bigner, and I have this phase diagram. This is as a function of the frequency of the cavity. The cavity will enter now, but as a function of the coupling, this J, you have paramagnetic phase. Then you, when G is sufficiently large, in this notation exactly at one, and the things is ferromagnetic, and in the other way around is antiferromagnetic when J is negative, because but here there is a minus sign here. So you have antiferromagnetism. Okay. Now we put this icing model inside a cavity, and we obtain this. The ferromagnetism is enhanced because if you couple to a single mode cavity, you can prove that the interactions that emerge are ferromagnetic. So essentially, this is the effective because it goes S squared, it goes with the square and only with lambda J. And then you are obtaining an effective all to all, in fact, typically ferromagnetic interaction between the spins. Okay. And then the ferromagnetism enlarged over the parameter. You can compute the parameter order, et cetera, et cetera. And then you obtain this. Okay. Let's go to a real example. So then you can have this material, which is iron 8, which is well described by an easy model. This is a spin 10 material with a dipolar interaction between the spins, okay? And there is an anisotropy, unaxial anisotropy. So it likes to be in the set direction. So the dipole interaction is always is also like theta theta. So it's a real it's a good material for realizing a Ising Hamiltonian, okay, in 3D. This is in fact these dots are experiments, okay, experimental points, and the solid line is the line that you will obtain with a simple since it's the dipolar interaction, it's long range, you can use mean field quite well, and it fits pretty well the phase down. So here is ferromagnetic, and here is paramagnetic. Okay.
Sorry, what is the y-axis?
Y-axis is the applied. This is magnetic field temperature phase down. Okay, so the typical, you know. So here this is the phase transition. Here is ferromagnetic, and this is paramagnetic. Okay. This is the t equals zero curve. Okay, as a function of the magnetic field. Now, so we have a material that it behaves like the Ising model I told you before, and then we can compute how the phase down will be modified. This is maybe very boring, but since it's enhanced. But what I would like to discuss with you is that everything depends only on the filling factor I told you. Okay, this is very nice. If obviously the better thing is to have the filling factor equal to one, and then you have this enhancement, which is very high enhancement. 0.5 means that you have filling factor 0.5, etc. What we wanted to do is just to convince the experimentalists is that already with 10% or 20% of the filling factor, you already start to observe something. Something that you can resolve in this way. Okay.
Why? Because there is a challenge, is that how to optimize the filling factor. For example, in the example I told you before, this is a cross section. This was the superconductors, and this, and on top, you put the material. Okay. What happens here? You are losing half of the mole volume because you, you cannot put material here. Okay. You only put material on one half. And the other thing is that you have my drawing aptitudes are not so very high, but I wanted to put here a gap here. Okay. Okay. You put a piece of material, and this gap is very important. Okay. You know, the fields are always larger in the corners and close to the to the superconductor. So I'm losing the points where more field are. Okay. And also here and here. So it's really a challenge to cover in this device the full mole volume of the gas. Okay. We are doing simulations now, trying to optimize these things. So where we are? Yesterday they showed me these photos. Okay. These are the facilities on Zaragoza. These are two cryostats. This is the one by, owned by Fernando, and this is by Pepa. The idea is that all these experiments, they need to be, so everything, the superconductors are in the microwave regime. So you need to go to the millikelvin. So you need to call these things at very low temperatures. And this is a typical photo of an experiment. So this black thing here is the superconductor, and then you put a sample on top of it. And you try to resolve the interaction between these materials and the resonator. Okay. In fact, in order to avoid to break down the sample, I don't know why, is they put some grease. Okay. Some grease, and then the grease again separates the sample from the resonator. So. So a lot of handicaps here. Okay, this is another sample. Sorry, but it's impossible to see it. But this is another device, which is not a cavity, but an LC resonator. An LC resonator is nothing but an LC resonator. So an inductor and a capacitor. Okay. Yeah, because if you call the LC resonator, and it is another thing. But the natural notation is like this. Okay. So the idea is to, in order to for example, you can imagine that you have an inductor like this, and then you can put inside the material inside the inductor. So in order to always to enhance or to optimize the filling factor. So we are thinking all this kind of device to enhance the filling factor. Okay. Foolish results.
Sorry. Why does the inductor enhance the filling factor?
Yeah, so it turns out that here, well, you know, you can have material only here. It's always difficult to design a sample that covers exactly like this because you need to go to a chemist and they synthesize the sample, and the sample, I mean, they don't make in purpose this geometrical form. Okay, you might like it. You might want to sell in a shop like it's like this. So, so you can maybe you cannot generate a material that covers exactly like this. Okay, but other thing you can do is design an LC resonator with geometrical thing that adapts to the typical geometry that appears from the synthesized material. Okay, this can be larger, thinner, or etc. Okay, and then the magnetic field is enhanced here, so you can adapt the sample to introduce inside the inductor in order to enlarge the coupling or enlarge the filling factor with the resonator. Okay, this is a kind of optimization we are trying now. So try. So this is more or less given. You can do some tricks, but maybe you can adapt the geometry to adapt this geometry to have a mole volume that fits with the material you want to prove. Because you want to cover as much as possible the most volume of the car. For example, here, these are real images. I think this is some microscopy, how it's called, electron microscopy image of organic radicals or real spin bond halves that will deepen they put up here the sample and then they deposit close to the central line of the resonator, okay, in order to enhance the curve. This is a kind of the number of spins that they deposit close to the central line, and this is the calculated coupling because of these spins. And for example, with this, we have not covered the mod volume. This paper was for other thing to prove that you can couple to these magnetic spins. For example, in this case, this cavity was 1.4 gigahertz, so we are always in the microwaves. And then the collective coupling, so the collective coupling of these, I don't remember the number of spins they have, was 2 megahertz, and they reached some values of optimal values of a single spin coupling of 85 hertz. So you always need to compare. I know that these numbers are smaller, very small for you because you are working in terahertz, but you need to compare these numbers with the cavity frequency. This is some numbers. And this is some anti-crossing that you can measure when you couple to the spin. So this is cavity QVD. This is very small decoupling. This is perturbative. Okay, but now we want to have more spins coupled to distance. Another experiment that has been done here related to this is this manuscript that we are now preparing, is that how to monitor a phase transition. Now the phase transition is not going to be induced by the coupling to the cavity, but the photons are going to monitor if a transition occurs in the system. Okay. Again, they measure the PPH free radicals that they have some antiferromagnetic coupling. These radicals form 1D arrays of one half spin antiferromagnetically coupled with some anisotropy, not very important, but essentially it's a nice realization of a 1D antiferromagnet. Okay, so essentially you can imagine this. Okay, the idea is that when the temperature are high, so high compared to the antiferromagnetic interaction, these spins are going to be independent. Okay, so essentially you have the independent spins. And if you measure the transmission through the, in this case was a wavelength, okay, you have photons traveling, interacting with independent emitters, so you can compute the visibility, and the visibility increase with the number of spins because you have this collective effect. So you have this what is called decay states, okay, and it goes with the temperature as a function of this function. This is the thermal factor. This is like what is called in the temperature the effective number of spins, okay, and this is what you can fit here. Sorry, I should put more temperature, okay, but when you decrease the temperature, then the antiferromagnetic interactions start to play a role. And then you go to the books, and then appears what is called the spin waves, okay, for magnetic spin waves. Okay, and the spin waves are not longer independent emitters, but they create us again harmonic oscillators, so they're waves. Okay, so essentially, here the transmission, you need to understand this transmission not as a photon interacting with one emitter, but a photon interacting with a spin wave, okay, with a K character. Okay, in this case, since the sample is very small and the photons are typically in the microwaves, is only you are resolving only the K equal to zero spin wave. Okay, and then one characteristic they measure more and we have more signatures, but one of the signatures is that the visibility of the spin wave, since it's a harmonic oscillator, does not depend on the temperature. Okay, it's a flat. So we see a transition between individual emitters and collective spin waves in the material just by looking at the transmission through the photons.
Okay.
These points are experiments. These lines is theory, is mean field theory, because it is, even if it is simple, it's not so simple to compute the things. So the mean field always overestimates. In fact, there is no, yeah, it's at 1D anti Fermat, there is no free transition. Yes, happy in the spin wave, but only with mean field, you predict some free transition that doesn't happen in the system. But well beyond this point here, the thin everything fits perfectly with the space. So this is my conclusions. So I think I told you, I explained you that how we develop this effective theory for emitters coupled to for cavities, and we discussed this application to magnetism, and now the experiments are in the position that we are trying to optimize this collective coupling to observe this modification of the material properties. But so far, what we can do is just monitoring properties of the materials by looking at the transmission, or they're going to the strong coupling, or to see the crossing, etc. In this case, I call this a kind of phase transition spectroscopy. We characterize this phase transition, and we have characterized also another phase transition. And we are still doing the theory of this. So this is the funding, and I would like obviously to acknowledge the people who have contributed to this work, especially to Sebas and especially to Juan. Juan is my PhD student that has been done all the work I told you, all the theoretical work. Sebas was doing the calculations for the last part of the monitoring of the phase transition. And also a lot of thanks to Fernando, who was the PI of the experimental. And thank you very much for your attention.
The next presentation, so the panel is for questions and comments or whatever.
I am wonderful. So you mentioned that at the very beginning that one material that can be used are perovskites. So perovskites with heavy elements have spin orbit coupling, and the spin orbit coupling is quite large. So do you have any, just on a general ground, intuition if the modeling of these kind of systems is going to be affected a lot by spin orbit couplings or not?
Well, I say this perovskite because it's paper, but I don't know nothing about perovskite, so.
Okay, yeah.
But yeah, this spin orbit coupling, okay, we neglect it because it's, but I mean, we can incorporate this spin orbit coupling. In fact, I think there is a paper, I don't want to say something wrong. I'm not sure, but in this incomplete list, I think there was a paper, I don't remember the name, and so I can tell you later, that it was related this spin orbit coupling to the possibility to observe this kind of super Ryan photocondensation. I can look for the paper.
Okay, yes, thanks.
Maybe this is important.
The question itself. Okay. Always when you talk to Thomas Everson and all the experiments with modifying matter by strong couplings, always he says that there is a resonant behavior in order to observe these changes in material properties. But in your case, for example, this is not the case. You don't have any resonance with any. So then. This is related to my second question about the number of moles that you include in your formulation. You always include only one cavity mole. That is not resonant behavior, and then you include only one cavity mole. So how is
okay? For example, this results here is only for one cavity mole. This is the Dicke model. This is a very big example, but this was only for one cavity mole. The general theory, of course, we include all the mode functions. So it's not, so far we have only done calculations with only one mode, but the point is that if we would like to have experiments with cavities, probably we will need to include more modes. But I think now we are moving to study these things with LC resonators, and in an LC resonator, it's a single mode because it's one frequency. But it's possible to include more modes. Respect the resonance thing, this is a question that some people have asked, not only to us, because other people are doing these things. And I don't have a, I mean, I can, let's say, avoid the question saying that what I'm doing is equilibrium physics.
Uh-huh.
But I'm not convinced that this is clearly, let's say, I would say the answer, right?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, but I don't know why the, I mean, I don't know, I cannot tell you, because the question is, okay, if you work with a single mode cavity, then essentially what you can do is imagine that your emitters, let's say, are very far the tube. So you expected that the coupling is decreased because you are the tube. That's true. but the point is that if you do the theory, then the effective, I mean, you have lambda over square root of n, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then the coupling goes like this. So for example, sigma x, like this. And this is over the cavity. And then you have here, obviously, if you have emitters, you always are going to have here the let's say the omega of the spins. So there's nothing. The only thing is that obviously, if you want to see some transition, you need to compare this energy with the coupling energy, right? But this will mean that maybe this, if this is very small, even compared to omega, this is super good. Obviously, if this is, if the omega is very large, then, but there's no resonance property. And I don't have
more questions.
Yes. I'm not sure I understood correctly. In that part of ferromagnetism,
uh-huh.
Did you say that once you get the effective Hamiltonian, it was a Sx squared thing? Yeah. So you have like this term Sx.
No, this is, sorry, this will be sigma xj.
Yeah,
it's sigma x.
But, okay, yeah.
So it's all to all.
Yeah, the sum of sigma x is Sx, right? It's the total spin.
Yes.
So it's Sx squared. Yes. And that modifies the critical point, right? That's what you're saying. But when I see this Sx squared thing, makes me think that you will have like a quantum behavior, or like you will modify the fluctuation of the spin, right? Like would you have spin squeezing or something like that? Have you looked into that, or you have any?
No, we didn't. I know what you mean, but we didn't go into
that. Do you already? I mean, yeah, I am saying nonsense, or that's
the, okay. This is a nice point. Yeah, we didn't.
One question. The effective Hamiltonian approximation, if we include many optical modes, does it still hold or does it change? Because you have frequencies in omega tends to zero, or you have many modes.
We assume that the number of modes are finite.
The frequency is not affecting the effective Hamiltonian, or?
No, the point that, but I'm sure. Well, not completely sure. The thing is that the n of the spin and modes is zero.
Independent of the frequency of the modes.
Yeah, this is independent of frequency. The thing I'm not sure is that. Imagine that you are, this is what happens, for example, with the spin boson model. The spin boson model, you have a continuous set of modes. Okay, I'm assuming that I have some discrete modes. Okay, and I can think, I consider 5, 6, 10, 30, whatever. But if I have a continuum of modes, and then the number of modes increase, okay, and the number either faster or at the, with the same length that the number of emitters, I cannot do this enlarge, because enlarge is not enlarge anymore, because I have also a lot of modes that interact, you know. So yeah. So I'm thinking
to the enlarged argument.
Yeah, I cannot do the enlarged argument if I have a continuum set of modes. But I consider that I have a cavity. If I have a cavity, I'm assuming that I have some discretization of the modes. Okay. But it's something we are thinking in how to explore, for example, some problem that imagine that you, instead of a cavity, you have a waveguide, then you have a continuum set of modes. And you put here an infinite set of modes. I think still the argument can be done, but I'm not sure. So I cannot tell you because we have not, but I have seen paper, I think it's a paper treating exactly this mode. So n infinity, the number of spins, and of course, here you have a continuous set of modes. You have already an infinite. But this is always this trick of which limit you do first, okay?
Thank you.
I have a question myself and then a few in the Zoom chat. I think it's related to what you have been discussing. How sensible do you think these effects are to inhomogeneities in the spin ensemble? So because you are treating them within this Dicke approximation, what about having some inhomogeneities in the spins?
Well, this is something we are exploring. I mean, if for example, if we have a single mode, then we have all to all. All to all is nice because you can solve, but somehow boring because you can use Minfield. But if you have some spatial distribution, then you have several modes, then you can do some kind of engineering between the couplings, you know? This is what we are trying to think on.
But not even the inhomogeneities don't need to be related to the electric field distribution, but to the spin ensemble the itself, no?
What do you mean, that the spins are different?
Like in...
Now we are doing calculation. For example, imagine that you put a spin randomly, okay, in a gravity. Randomly, you have some random couplings. So now we are exploring how to induce kind of many body localization just by putting. So this position of emitters with inhomogeneities or randomness are affected to the kind of effective interaction that you are obtaining.
So then Ricardo and Cheita wrote the following. So when the normalized coupling is large, one may have a lot of virtual excitations. For all of your observables, did you take into account such virtual excitations? Otherwise, one can end up in a situation of permanent radiation on the ground of the ground state.
I don't know if I understand. Yeah, we obtain this let's say there is a lot of, in fact, there is a macroscopic population of photons there. Obviously, they are at equilibrium, and then you cannot measure unless you do some tricks, some perturbations over some quench over the vacuum. But you have a lot of excitations there. Yeah, but they don't radiate because they are at the equilibrium. So it's like the zero point fluctuations. You have a lot of, yeah. I don't know if I understood the question, but.
Well, I think Ricardo, Ricardo, you can clarify. While I share with you the other question from Sigmund Koller, can one observe measure any time dependence of the spin waves?
Well, I'm not an experimentalist. So what I know is that what we can do, and this is very nice, it's not related to this, but for me it was very nice, is that they can monitor the by transmission, okay, by sending different wave packets, they were able to measure the decay of the two-level atom. So for example, you have this transmission experiment, very simple. You have 1D, you have a two-level system, okay? And then you see some resonance at the delta frequency. But now imagine that before you send a pulse that excites the two-level system. Okay. If the two-level system is excited and you send a second pulse, nothing happens. Okay. So essentially, by sending several pulses depending on the time, they are always to monitor the decay. So I don't know if they induce some dynamics of the spin waves. I don't have the numbers in mind how far they can send and how they monitor them. I know that because I saw the experiment that they can monitor the relaxation dynamics of these two level systems by doing this, but I'm not sure about the spin waves dynamics.
Okay, there's no more questions.
Okay, more questions and comments? If not, let's thank David.